planting here. It's quite jungly. And again, that's, you know, that's all intentional. I don't want to have many open gaps because it's only invitations for plants that I don't want to come in, which are usually ash trees, you know, or perhaps brambles. So, you know, there's lots going on here. At the back, there's a berberis, which has just finished flowering. Let's see, one or two yellow flowers still on it. But that's an extra element of windbreak from the west because this is quite a thin strip in terms of width of conifers. And there's an open field the other side. And you can see through, you know, where the light is. That's the field the other side. So, and they haven't got many branches low down. So the wind can whistle underneath them a little bit. So that's an extra element of windbreak, really. And fantastic bee plants for berberis. You can eat all berberis fruits, but they're very small, not really worth mainly trying to eat. And the birds love them too. So I don't really regard it as a fruit crop. In front of those, you can see a line of conifers. And those are plum yews. That's a Chinese fruit plant. You can see the fruits on this one forming. They're not the same family as yew. It's a different family, Cephalotaxus. But like you, you get female and male trees, or shrubs in this case, really. And you've got to have both if you want fruit to form. So I planted out a line of six. Six I grew from seed here. And there's three of each, in fact. That one's a male at the end, so no fruits on that, but it's a female next to it here. And fruits on plum yew are really nice to eat. They ripen after everything else in November, after some frosts. And they turn from green to brown and become soft with a flavour like butterscotch with a bit of pine resin flavour in there as well, kind of resinous flavour to them. Very nice eating. And very shade tolerant fruits as well. And in front of those, a few other things that are more common and you'll recognise. So for example, that flowering quince. This is just Japonica, Phanomyles japonica, which has, the fruits are very small and still green on it, you can see. But of course they get to about, you know, 5 centimetres diameter and turn yellowish green when they're ripe in early autumn. Very easy to grow plant, right? It's in a lot of people's gardens really. But it, as a fruit plant, it's great. You know, I really highly value that fruit. Not as a fruit to just eat, because it's very acid, but it's very citrusy. Particularly, this one is particularly lemony. Other Chinomeles are sometimes more orangey in terms of the citrus flavour in them. And I make summer drinks, mostly, from these fruits. Like still lemonade type drinks.
Juicing them or?
I whiz them in a blender to get the flavour from them. Also, there are things like red currants. This is a red currant here. And of course, in a normal garden situation, you don't normally see red currants, maybe two metres high, but that's how high they'll grow if you don't prune them every year. And I don't prune them every year because they fruit perfectly well without that. There's no reason to prune if you don't need to. So I would certainly question ordinary gardening wisdom that says you've got to prune everything every year because it's just a load of work and sometimes it's completely pointless. Sometimes, you know, pruning can be useful. I'm not saying never prune, but I always start from a basis of not pruning and only prune if it's really necessary. And if a fruiting plant like this continues to put on lots of new growth for future fruiting and fruits well, that's fine. Leave it be, you know, just let it get on with it. A lot of my red currants are this kind of size, and other, you know, common fruit bushes as well.
Are there